Hello, everybody. Good morning. Welcome on behalf of everybody at ISP Supplies to the RF Elements product overview. I'd like to wish everybody a happy Valentine's Day here. Thank you for joining us. And today's going to be a really good webinar. We're going to go over all of the current product offerings of RF Elements, including their beamforming horn antennas, twist board adapters, and go over some products that we're going to see in the near future here. So we're very excited. We have Tasos on the line with us. And Tasos, it's all yours. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Jonathan. Good morning, everybody. Good afternoon. My name is Tasos. I'm with RF Elements. And today we'll be doing our product overview, which is we'll go over the kind of horn antenna and twist port adapter ecosystem that we currently offer. At the end of the webinar, we'll have a question and answers segment. So in your little app there, you should see a question box. If anything that I'm talking about is not clear, if you have any questions or anything maybe that I don't go over in this overview that you want to ask, feel free to type them in now or start typing as questions pop into your head, and I'll take them all at the end, as well as follow-up questions if you have them. So with that, we'll get started here. So if we look at the RF Elements product map, we kind of break up our products into a couple different segments. You see that the top two are our symmetrical beam antennas. These are beams with symmetrical beams. In the middle are our asymmetrical beam pattern antennas. And at the bottom, we have our twist port adapters, the part of our ecosystem that allows us to connect most of the common connectorized radios that are on the market from the most common manufacturers, to then be able to work with our antenna systems. So to start, we'll start with our twist port adapters, and we'll go into some detail about what the adapter is, how it works, and what they're compatible with. So this right here is actually our twist port. It is the proprietary waveguide interface that we created that are on all of our twist port antenna systems. The twist port is again what allows you to connect and mount your connectorized or waveguide fed radio into our twist port antennas. Our twist port system actually delivers zero loss. So in our original reference design, we decided to get away from the connectors and the SMAs that everybody sees on the current radio platforms and create waveguide fed radios or waveguide fed systems for going into our antennas. So on the right, you see the old standard of a connectorized radio. You simply delete the pigtails. You put the waveguide feed onto the actual board itself, eliminating all that loss. And then you create a waveguide fed twist port radio that attaches to all of our twist port antennas. So more detail, well, what's an actual twist port adapter? The twist port adapter is, it solves the problem of connectorized radios. It solves the problems of the external pigtails and such, and allows you to take the more popular connectorized radios that are on the market right now and convert them into a waveguide fed radio system, which then again allows you to connect all these really popular radios on the market with our twist port antennas systems. One thing that's very important to note as our product portfolio for antennas has grown, that the twist port adapters themselves connect to any twist port antenna that we offer. So whether it's a parabolic dish, like our ultra dish twist port antenna, whether it's our high gain ultra horn antenna, our older or our original, I should say, symmetrical horn antennas, or even our newest asymmetrical horn antennas, those twist port adapters that you have work on all of those antennas. The twist port adapters themselves are specific for the specific radio you want to use. So there is an adapter for every radio, but every adapter works on all of our antennas. So one of the popular radios on the market or manufactured on the market is cambium. And we offer a couple of twist port adapters for cambium networks. So if you're running the older EPMP 1000 radio, we have a twist port adapter for that specific radio. Now, the EPMP 1000, I believe, comes in about three different variations. You have the regular EPMP 1000, then you have an EPMP 1000 Lite, I believe. And there's even an EPMP 1000 sync or something like that. So basically, it's the EPMP 1000 line. There's three different variants of the radio, but all the same form factor. This one single adapter allows you to work with any of those three radio platforms. If you're running the EPMP 2000 radios, again, we have a specific adapter for that radio. So here we see the twist port adapter for EPMP 2000. Just like all our adapters, the radios simply slide and lock into the actual adapter itself, securing it, and then with the simple push of the red or gray release button, allows you to remove that radio if it needs to be replaced or upgraded or something. And again, this EPMP 2000 twist port adapter, like all of our adapters, work with any of our twist port antennas. If you're a Microtech user, we have twist port adapters for Microtech as well. The twist port adapters for Microtech are generally for the small square form factor router boards that they manufacture, like the router board 411, 911, the older 711s, and even the new M11 series boards. So here we have the twist port adapter for router board. This is our plastic enclosure twist port adapter. So you can see, you can take here, I believe this is like a 922 board. You slide it in the insert, you secure it in place with screws, you connect the internal pigtails, and you slide it up into the adapter. So if you're using any of the Microtech router board, small form factor, 9 series, 7 series, 4 series, or even the new M series, this twist port adapter will work for you. And this is the router board plastic, or the RBP. For people who are looking for more EMI protection, we also make the RBC, which is the router board cast, or this is a full metal enclosure for better EMI protection. Again, you just put your board in there. With here we're looking at the M11, but again, you could put a 911, 922. There are multiple board form factors that work with this adapter. You insert it, and then now you have a twist port enabled router board to work with any of our, again, twist port antennas. If you're a Ubiquiti user, we make many adapters. This is probably the largest offering of adapters we make based on the largest number of actual Ubiquiti radios that are available on the market. So the first adapter is our twist port adapter for ISO station. So the ISO station is one of Ubiquiti's newer round waveguide fed type radio system. So again, they have a waveguide radio, and our twist port adapter for ISO station is simply just a waveguide converter. So it converts their proprietary waveguide into our kind of open standard waveguide format, and therefore allowing it to work again with any of our twist port enabled antennas that we have to offer. As far as compatibility, there are three different form factors for this one adapter. So if you're running the Ubiquiti ISOstation M5, the Ubiquiti ISOstation 5AC, the larger Ubiquiti Prism Station AC, or even coming in the future, sometime soon, the Ubiquiti Air Fiber LTU radio. So for any of these four kind of round waveguide fed radios from Ubiquiti, this single adapter, the twist port adapter ISO station, will work for any of these four form factors. The next adapter we have is for the Ubiquiti Rocket 5 AC Prism and also the Air Fiber 5X. So if you're running any of those radios, the twist port adapter PFA, or PAF, which stands for Prism Air Fiber, we have one adapter that works for both of these platforms. As you can see, again, They just simply slide in and lock in place, and then you have a simple release button that releases the radio and allows you to drop it out. Another really cool feature of our twist port adapter for prism and air fiber is we've integrated a slot to mount the GPS puck. So you no longer have to have the GPS wire and adapter or GPS puck outside, you know, with tie wraps or electrical tape, or you don't have to look for some sort of steel part of your structure, whether it's the pipe or the tower itself, to magnetically stick the GPS antenna. Now you can protect the antenna and the very delicate wire, the GPS wire, all safely stored inside of the adapter, and therefore you increase the life of the GPS antenna and protect it from the elements. As far as compatibility for this particular adapter, again, if you're running the Ubiquiti Rocket Prism 5AC, which is the original Prism AC radio, or their newer Gen 2 Rocket 5 Prism AC, the original or older Air Fiber 5X, or their newest Air Fiber 5X HD, I think it's also known as LTU, this one adapter will work with all of these different radios. So one adapter for four different radios, and again, the adapter is compatible with all of our twist port enabled antennas. If you're running a legacy system or you have some legacy radios, we also have a twist port adapter for the old Rocket M5. So this is, again, one of the original connectorized AP radios from Ubiquiti. It's in the plastic enclosure. Again, if you have any of these on your network and you're looking to upgrade the antenna performance, you can get the Rocket M5 twist port adapter and then enable that radio for our twist port system. Here it says available January 2019. It already started shipping, so you can probably find it at your distributor. And then finally, for Ubiquiti, we also have a twist port adapter for the older legacy Rocket 5 AC. This is also known on the market as the Rocket 5 AC Lite, I believe. So again, this is the first generation AC radio, non-prism, from Ubiquiti. So if you have any of these on your current network, or you have some in your storeroom, or you want to use it maybe for smaller installs, whatever it may be, we have the Rocket 5 AC, or the R5 AC twist port adapter for that particular radio. Mimosa Networks is the final radio or manufacturer that we build twist port adapters for. So if you're running the C5C connectorized radio from Mimosa, again, we have a twist port adapter for that. So the C5C radio with our C5C twist port adapter allows you to use that radio with any of our twist port antennas. And then finally, for all other radios. So if there's a 5 gigahertz outdoor radio system that you're using and we do not have a twist port adapter for, we have a connectorized twist port adapter now. So the connectorized twist port adapter is simply a waveguide adapter with two SMA connectors on there. So you would take, let's say, your PMP 550 or your PMP 450i from Cambium, or perhaps even Mimosa's A5C radio. These radios are a very large form factor, and a twist port adapter is just not really suitable for that particular radio platform for any sort of reason, whether it's size or technology. You could use our twist port adapter SMA to connect those radios and then utilize them with our twist port antenna system. And the twist port adapter SMA works just like all other ones, right? So again, it's pretty simple. Once you connect the LMR, the twist port adapter just twists and locks into the radio, into the antenna, and therefore allows you to make the interface and utilize our antennas. So that's our twist port connector series. Moving on from there, we go to our symmetrical beam pattern, or here is our Gen 2 symmetrical horn antennas. So the symmetrical horn twist port series, this is our generation 2. This is the original, or the first horn antenna that we had brought to market. And the symmetrical horns have a very unique property of them, of noise isolation and many other very interesting things. So the main part is that it's a symmetrical beam. That means that the azimuth cut and the elevation cut are the same. So the beam pattern actually has the same distance in vertical that it does in horizontal. So it's just as tall as it is wide. So it's a very symmetrical beam pattern, which brings you some very unique properties. If we were to compare it to a traditional sector, like you look on the left, you can see that the beam patterns, again, for a sector are very unique. So a traditional sector antenna or patch array sector usually has a very narrow vertical beam and a much wider horizontal beam. And what I mean by that is how wide it is versus how tall it is, not the vertical and horizontal polarities of the antenna. So you can see that the shape comparison of the beam is quite different than what you're used to with traditional sectors. Another great benefit of our symmetrical horn antennas is that they have absolutely zero side lobes, right? So if we look at the RF simulation on the left of our 90 degree symmetrical horn, you can see that it has a very uniform and beautiful beam shape that comes out of it with zero side lobes and no back radiation. If you were to compare that to a competitive patch array sector on the right, you can see how the beam pattern of that and the simulation shows how the RF goes out way beyond its spec beam width, with a lot of RF leakage out the back and very complex side lobes. Because of our very unique vertical beam pattern, symmetrical horns have very small or almost no null zone. The null zone is the dead zone that you typically see close into the tower. So if you look at the coverage area of a symmetrical horn on the left compared to a traditional sector on the right, you can see that in comparison, the dead zone or the null zone to the tower is much, much smaller. So this null coverage area is actually one of the benefits that you get. So the close-in customers get really good connections as well. Frequency stability is, again, another great benefit of horn antennas. They are extremely stable across the whole frequency spectrum. So here, if you watch, as we kind of sweep through the frequency from lower 5 up to 6 gigahertz, you can see how the actual RF pattern changes in three dimensions on the left. If you look on the right, you can look at the two-dimensional coverage map. You can see, again, how your coverage area or how that beam would actually change in the coverage area where your customers are. Again, it's very stable and it doesn't fluctuate as much as a traditional sector. Here we show you the frequency instability of a traditional sector. So on the left, you see your regular patch array sector. And you can see as we change frequency, not only does the beam pattern change, but also the side lobes grow, not only in intensity, but also complexity. The most important thing for your coverage area, if you look on the right in two dimensions, you can see how your coverage area as frequency changes can either grow or shrink. And this is really one of the biggest problems of traditional sectors. You know, they're typically, you know, kind of perceived as great when you install them. You get your customers on, you know where your customers can be and can't be. You get them all signed up and everything is great. And then at some point, noise rears its head. And you have to change channels. It's a natural part of being a WISP, is having to work with the unlicensed band and finding free channels. So as you start changing channels, you find a new channel, all of a sudden you have customers that had good connections who now have marginal connections, or customers who had marginal connections that now have terrible connections. So this is because of the type of antenna that you're using. Because that beam pattern is changing, you're losing signal intensity in certain areas and maybe even growing intensity in other areas. And this really creates a hard problem for you to maintain your network as you're dealing with noise. So the frequency instability of a traditional sector is horrible compared to a horn antenna. And then finally, signal density. One of the other great benefits of horn antennas is that they are extremely, extremely precise. So the signal density shows you how the signal starts to drop off as you go to the edge of a of a horn antenna or any antenna, I should say. So here we can see in the different colors where the 3 dB drop-off, the 6 dB drop-off, and even the 12 dB drop-off is on a horn antenna. So you can see you don't have to go very far past the edge of the spec'd beam angle of a horn antenna before the signal really starts to drop off. If you look at a traditional sector on the right, you can see that the bleed off or the signal drop off is much, much slower, which makes traditional sectors very hard for controlling your RF pattern because they typically bleed and go way further than the spec'd angle. So if you're buying a, let's say, 65 degree traditional sector, you're more than likely capable of using that at up to 90 degrees or even beyond. 90 degree sectors typically go out to about 180 degrees in effective antenna gain, and therefore make it really hard for you to plan your coverage. And this is what starts causing the issues for co-location with you, not to mention the side lobes, right? So this is just mainly the kind of signal density of the main beam. So you add all that stuff together, a horn antenna gives you much better signal density and a much better control over your RF network. Our symmetrical horn series come in 7 different sizes. So we have everything from a 30 degree all the way up to a 90 degree horn in 10 degree steps. So from 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90. One thing to note is as you go wider in the beam angle of a symmetrical horn, the gain drops as well. So it's really important to note the relationship here where our 90 degree horn, for example, has 9.5 or 9.6 dBi of gain measured at the -6. You can't just typically take a 90 degree symmetrical horn and replace a 90 degree traditional sector because of the gain difference. You're probably not going to get the range, right? So this is something just to pay attention to when you're trying or thinking about planning out or adding horns to your network, is paying attention to the actual gain versus the beam angle. And there's some great benefits to all of this. Our horn antennas are also very compact in size, right? So they're about a quarter of the size of a traditional sector. So this compact size allows you to really pack AP density on your tower, right? So you can mount anywhere between 3 to maybe up to 4, depending on what sector you're using, in the same vertical space as a traditional sector. So the horn antennas, our symmetrical horn antennas, are very compact and allow you to mount many more APs in the same vertical space as a traditional sector. All this stuff, when we bring it together, really creates this co-location miracle. Honestly, the precise radiation angles, the noise isolation, the lack of side lobes, all of these things put together really give you the ability to co-locate like you've never been able to do with traditional sectors. Not only the small space so you can stack these things on a tower, not only the reduced wind load, not only reducing wind load even further because you don't need, you know, third-party shielding kits, really everything. These horn antennas kind of address all the issues of the, you know, current sector technology that people are using, and really fixes all of those problems. If you look at the competitive sector antennas on the right, you can see how they receive noise not only because they're capable of hearing past their, you know, their spec beam angle, but also all the side lobes and everything interact on the same tower or even to other towers and really create issues for you and reduce your overall network throughput. Here are some pictures in the field to kind of show you the co-location miracle we're talking about. So we don't just say you can mount these things very close together. These are actual WISPs out there and how they're doing it. And you can actually see how close you can mount these things together. And you just do not get this type of co-location capabilities out of any other antenna on the market today. By offering so many different beam patterns and beam angles and gains, we really give you this massive scalability again. It gives you the ability to create beam patterns and cover areas where your customers actually are, to ignore areas where noise is or you don't want to hear from. So mixing and matching all 7 of our different horn antennas really give you the ability to, again, paint your coverage area, be responsible to not send a signal where it doesn't need to go, to not hear signal from where you don't want it, and really just putting the RF signature out to where your customers is and where your customers actually are. So the massive scalability is capable with RF element symmetrical horn antennas. The antennas themselves are, very durable. If you've never seen one before, I think you'd be quite surprised or quite happy when you receive it to see that it's very durable. We use very high quality stainless steel, extruded aluminum, very UV resistant HDPE plastics and UV rated plastics, ABS plastics. So all the materials that we use to build our antennas are made to last, right? To not corrode and not degrade over time. So a very durable build and made to last the lifetime of your radio, at least, and then beyond. Here again are just some more deployments out in the field that kind of show you with different radio platforms, whether it's Microtech or Ubiquiti, how these antennas, again, can be co-located with not only other horn antennas and sector antennas and backhaul antennas. Really coexisting is great. And finally, some last pictures of deployments that are out there. So now we're going to cover our ultra horn, which is our point-to-point antenna. So the ultra horn is a 15-degree wide, 24 dBi horn antenna, specifically made for point-to-point. Like our symmetrical horn antenna, it still has a symmetrical beam. So it's highly precise. It's 15 degrees wide and 15 degrees tall. Our ultra horn still possesses the same frequency stability that we saw previously. So as we change channels, you can see how the beam pattern in three dimensions or in two dimensions is extremely, extremely stable. Our ultra horn also has zero side lobes. So if you compare it to a parabolic dish antenna on the left, you can see all the complex side lobes and how those side lobes can receive and create noise for your network. One thing here is the shroud effect. So a lot of people like to put shrouds on their dish antennas and the parabolic dish antennas and to see some better co-location. And here on the left, we see a parabolic dish antenna without a shroud. So you can see all the complex side lobes that a parabolic dish antenna has, specifically perpendicular to the main beam or at the edges. And when you put a shroud on the right, you can see that same antenna. Really, you're not really creating a better beam pattern or more noise isolation. You're simply just changing the beam pattern and creating even more complex side lobes. If we look at it in more of a two dimension, you can see when we add a shroud, all it does is it just takes all those side lobes and just basically pushes it forward and squishes it forward. So this is without. And then this is what it looks like with a shroud on it. So again, it creates a kind of better co-location experience on the tower where it's mounted, but it's really changing the fundamental principles of the radiation pattern forward facing. So it affects the connection more than it does save you on the co-location on a tower. So having no side lobes is really the best thing to do. So true noise rejection, you can see on the left with a horn antenna with no side lobes and no back radiation compared to parabolic dish antennas. Our horn antennas also have the ultimate performance in gain, right? So if we look at the gain across the spectrum, you can see it's extremely stable. If you compare this to other manufacturers on the market of parabolic dish antennas, usually the gain that they spec is the peak gain. It's usually in one frequency across the whole band, and it's usually sometimes even in one polarity. So our vertical and horizontal gain is identical, and you can see it's very stable and very flat across the spectrum. So if you're changing channels from Uni 1 to Uni 2 to Uni 3, you know that you're still getting the same effective spec gain of that antenna across the whole spectrum without losing much and great performance there. Our ultra horn also makes alignment very easy, right? So without having any side lobes like a parabolic dish antenna does, if you look at how many times you can possibly misalign an antenna because the side lobe intensity is so high, you could still receive a decent signal and be connected to a side lobe, where with a ultra horn on the left, you can see you're either in main beam connectivity and have a great perfect connection, or you're out, right? So antenna alignment is easier and more robust with the ultra horn. Also, the ultra horn, you know, is not just a high performance point to point, it's also a high performance point to multipoint. So if you have a cluster of customers that are within the 15 degree spec beam angle, there's no reason why you can't use it as a high performance point to multipoint antenna as well. Really, when it comes down to it, the antennas don't care. It's just a matter of whether that antenna possesses the specific parameters that you need for either point to point or point to multipoint. And the ultra horn can do both. Like all of our antennas, again, extremely durable build, right? So we use the same stainless steel, high-grade plastics, aluminum, and even higher quality other types like zinc and other metal layers, right? So built to last and not corrode and last a lifetime of your network. If we look at some of the deployments in the field here, you can see on the left and in the middle, these are actually very high-density point-to-multipoint using the ultra horn. On the right, we see a point-to-point. This is actually a 15-mile link with EPMP 1000. So this is a 24 dBi horn antenna doing a 15-mile link. Nobody would ever think to do it. This 24 dBi ultra horn replaced 30 dBi dishes, and all their problems went away. They're solid MCS 1450-15. It's been running for almost a year now, coming up, I think, on 8 months maybe or something like that. So close to a year. Even solved a thermal inversion problem that they were having with their parabolic dish antenna. So clearly, the ultra horn, even though it's perceived as low gain to what people are used to, really outperform many parabolic dish antennas on their links. Again, here you can see some more in the field and point-to-point, some co-located with sectors and other antennas. So really great antenna. It's performing fantastic. It's fantastic in the field. So now in our symmetrical type beam pattern, we'll move to our ultra dish, which is our parabolic dish antenna. So the ultra dish series of antennas are, again, 5 gig antennas that we offer two variants of. So we have the ultra dish 400, which is a 24.5 dBi antenna. And then we also have the Ultra Dish 550, which is a 27.5 dBi antenna. Again, these are both twist port antennas, so they become compatible with all of our twist port adapters. So our Ultra Dish is a parabolic dish, right? So it still possesses side lobes, but we've created it in such a way that we were actually able to suppress some of the side lobe. So you'll see really good performance out of our parabolic dish, our Ultra Dish 400 and 550, still possessing side lobes, but really good side lobe suppression. So really great performance. The Ultra Dish also has very stable gain, like all of our antennas. So the vertical and horizontal beams themselves have the same gain. So they match, and you can see that the gain across the spectrum is extremely stable, right? So again, as you change channels from Uni 1 to Uni 2 to Uni 3, you can ensure that you're going to get pretty close to the actual spec gain no matter what channel you are you're in. They also make great CPEs. So a lot of people like to use high gain panel antennas for CPEs and high density AP locations. And what you can see is that the complex side lobes from these antennas are actually capable of hearing multiple APs at the same time. So directional patch array antennas aren't really the best. Using an ultra dish for these high noise environments with suppressed side lobes give you the ability to, again, focus mainly on the AP you want and not hear the other APs. So it's a great design for CPE as well as point-to-point. So something to consider there. Our Ultra Dish also has a very innovative mount. So the mount only requires two bolts and you're done, right? So no more fussing around with a bag of bolts and washers and nuts and locking washers and all this other stuff. So all our screws are captive screws. You can see very innovative mount for adjusting elevation and azimuth. Again, two bolts and you're done. In most cases, you can mount the first bolt on the mount. And then really you're just putting one screw in when you get up to the top of the tower. So very innovative mount, brought to you from RF Elements. If you look at the deployments in the field, again, they're used for not only point-to-point, but also for CPE. So here we see a few different variants here with Ubiquiti Prism, Mimosa, C5C, and backhaul, and even as a CPE at a customer's house. So great for all different types of deployments. So now we're going to move into the asymmetrical horn patterns, or our asymmetrical horn twist port antennas. So the asymmetrical horn twist port series is our newest horn antenna. And these antennas are different than our current horn antennas in that they have an asymmetrical beam pattern versus symmetrical. So if we look at our 30 degree asymmetrical horn, you can see that it's actually 30 degrees wide, but only 20 degrees tall. The 60 degree asymmetrical is 60 degrees wide, but only 25 degrees tall. And our 90 is 90 degrees wide and only 25 degrees tall. So this allows us to focus the RF energy better and deliver you more gain at wider beam angles. So this is kind of the more sector feel that you're used to, with no side lobes and much better RF connections. So again, we have, you know, the most perfect beam coverage with our asymmetrical horns, still giving a small null zone, but giving you the very unique coverage area of high gain with wide azimuth and narrow vertical beam width. Like all our horns, they have absolutely zero side lobes. So here we can look at a 60 degree asymmetrical horn. Again, you see a very beautiful, very uniform RF pattern with no side lobes and no back radiation. And again, if we compare it to your competing patch array sector on the right, again, you can see very sloppy, lots of complex side lobes and a lot of back radiation. So no shielding kits, nothing else is needed. You get the perfect antenna for the perfect coverage. You still get great frequency stability with our asymmetrical horns. It's everything that you expect from RF elements. So if you look at the three-dimensional radiation pattern or the two-dimensional map coverage, you can see as we sweep through the frequency from 5 up to 6 gigahertz, you can see that the coverage area stays very stable. So again, if you run into noise issues and you need to change channels or you need to add capacity, whatever it may be, whatever reason you have to change channels for, you know that the coverage area that you planned out to begin with will not deviate much from the original plan, and therefore all your customers will still have very close to what they originally had as you change channels. This right here is probably the most important thing to note, that we have very balanced horizontal and vertical beams. So that means your horizontal beam and your vertical polarity beam are practically, you know, exactly match. If we look at traditional sectors, usually one of the polarities, whether it's vertical or horizontal, is usually much wider than the other. And this gives you huge chain mismatch errors as you get to the side and the edges of that coverage area. And with our asymmetrical horns, you get balanced horizontal and vertical beams, and therefore you get perfect chain-to-chain performance throughout that coverage area, unlike your traditional patch array sector, where you have very unbalanced horizontal and vertical beams, very unbalanced vertical and horizontal gain. There's nothing like an asymmetrical horn beam pattern out there right now in the market. So these antennas are really great for rural deployments. This is where you might have a very low density of customers, but a very wide distance, or a much longer distance or area that you have to cover. So this is where you may not be able to, or your business model doesn't support running, let's say, 12, 30 degree symmetrical horns to give you 360 degree coverage. So now with our asymmetrical horns with the higher gain and the wider beam azimuths, you can use these in rural deployments and cover areas that you possibly, you know, couldn't do before. And again, looking at traditional patch array sectors, you have no side lobes with our horns, and therefore you still get all the noise isolation that you need and co-location capabilities. So even though we only offer three different azimuths or beam angles, 30, 60, and 90, you still get in rural areas the same ability to kind of build your coverage and only send signal and only hear signal from areas that you want, and still give you that great noise isolation and massive scalability. Again, like all of our antennas, they're built to last and very durable. So again, we use all the same types of products or materials in all of our antennas. So you know, you can be rest assured that the antennas are built to last and will last the life of your network. So finally, we're moving to our symmetrical horn carrier class. So a symmetrical horn carrier class is just like the symmetrical horns that we showed earlier without the twist port. So basically, these are connectorized twist port, connectorized symmetrical horn antennas. So if you have radios or your network only runs kind of those larger form factors like EPNP 450 or something like that, there's no need for you to have a twist port or a connectorized twist port adapter. You can simply get all seven of our symmetrical horns with the end connectors built in, therefore reducing the complexity of your install. Again, all the same RF performance that you saw earlier from symmetrical horn antennas, all the great noise isolation, no side lobes, flat gain, you name it. All the same performance, just with end connectors built in. We also offer the ultra horn that we saw earlier in the carrier class series as well. So again, if you're running only PMP 550s or some other sort of large radio for backhaul, maybe B5C from Mimosa. Again, no need to get a twist port antenna and then a twist port adapter. You can simply buy the carrier class series of the ultra horn, and therefore you're ready to go with end connectors built in. And again, here are some deployments out in the field. You can see a Mimosa A5C on the left. You can see again with the carrier class horn, there's no need for the twist port adapter SMA and then the cable. So here's some deployments. On the right, you can see this is actually EPMP 2000 all the way on the right. This is before we had a twist port adapter available for it. So again, if you want all the great performance of a horn antenna and there's no twist port adapter available, you can simply just get our carrier class line. And then finally, our carrier class sectors. So our carrier class sectors is our original antenna. This is our patch array sector from like 7 years ago or something like that, right? So we offer two different carrier class sectors, which are, you know, again, you know, patch array type sectors. We have one SKU in 2.4 gigahertz. It's the SEC CC214, and it's a 14 dBi 2.4 gigahertz sector, and it's spec'd at 100 degrees wide. On the right, you see our 5 gigahertz variant. This one is a 20 dBi sector, and again, it's 100 degrees wide. So we have, again, traditional sectors as well, but this is our legacy product for anybody who's interested in those. Even though it's a patch array sector, it's actually still very unique. So what we did is we created a back shield that's built in and tuned specifically for this antenna. So when you go out and you buy an antenna that's poorly designed, and then you decide to spend some money on poorly designed shield kits and add them on, you really start running into problems because, again, you can't just take a metal surface and strap it to the back of your sector and expect everything to work properly. They actually have to be designed and balanced and everything to work with your actual patch array. So our back shield is actually some special frequency selective surfaces, and these frequency selective surfaces help us attenuate the back radiation, not just put a ground plane behind it, but specifically tuned to attenuate that signal. But it also helps us form the beams, which is really important. So we showed earlier how mainstream sectors usually have a vertical and a horizontal beam, which is very unbalanced. Usually one's wider than the other. Sometimes gain is higher than the other in either vertical or horizontal, depending on the sector. But our back shield actually helps us form the beam so that the vertical and horizontal beams are as closely matched as they can be for a patch array sector. So you get very, very good chain-to-chain performance out of a traditional legacy patch array sector antenna. And here we see some deployments again in the field. So you can see you can still co-locate our carrier class sectors very close together and use them in many different ways. The carrier class sector line also has the kind of slide and click in lock radio slot. So if you're using like Rocket M5s or Prisms or even EPMP 1000, they just slide and click on the back so you don't have to find or use tie wraps or tape or some other mounting apparatus for the radio. So they just slide and click in the back, and the pigtails are protected with our original pigtail cover that slides in the top. So actually a really great performing patch array traditional sector if you still need that on your network. Really at RF Elements, we're kind of setting the new industry standards. I mean, we see this every day. For those of you who know us, you're seeing it as well in other products that are coming to the market, right? So we set the standard for noise rejection in bringing the very unique properties of horn antennas to this industry. We also set the standard of zero loss or near zero loss by transitioning radios on the market from connectorized radios with pigtails and connectors and needing tape and all this other stuff to seal them to waveguide fed. So it's a new industry standard that we've set over 4 years ago and continue to set that standard moving forward. And really we're delivering on the massive scalability. Up until now, it was really not possible or very difficult to be able to get the very extremely high density AP density on your towers to give you massive scalability. We have customers with thousands of horn antennas on their network. We have customers with dozens of horn antennas on a single tower, right? So I think 20 or 24 plus was the largest amount of APs. And when we first came to the industry with this and we talked about what was possible, people said, I don't even have enough channels. I don't even have three extra channels to put three horns on my tower. And we showed that over time, it was really the noise rejection and the low loss of our ecosystem that gave you the ability to reuse channels and really bring this massive scalability to the market. Like all of our antennas, again, they're all built the same, right? So they all use the same type of, you know, zinc alloys, aluminum alloys, stainless steel, high quality outdoor resistant plastics. Really, we aim for excellence in outdoor resistance from the elements. And also we focus on the usability of the climber, right? So whether you're the WISP owner, the WISP operator, or the climber, the installer, you can really appreciate the time that we put into designing how these things are built, how they're put together, and how they're installed in the field. So really, we've knocked it out of the park on many of these points, not just focused on one. We didn't just focus on gain. We didn't just focus on beam angle. We didn't just focus on mounting apparatus. We didn't just focus on ease of use. We focused on everything to bring you the ultimate solution. Finally, another note on our hardware. We use all stainless steel hardware. So stainless steel hardware needs the use of anti-seize lubricant, right? So the bolts that you use to mount this, stainless steel is known to gald, right? It's known to bond to each other when friction is applied. So all you have to do is just use some cheap anti-seize that you get at the auto parts store, just put some on the threads and you'll ensure that you know, you'll be able to use and reuse and remove these antennas over and over again as you move them through your deployment. So please use anti-seize. And finally, some ecological packaging, right? So we've also thought about the environment, right? So you know, we've reduced the amount of styrofoam we used to have. We used recycled cardboard as well. So we've put some thought behind that as well. Our YouTube channel. So we have so much information available to the public, whether it's on our website or our YouTube channel is really a great place to go. I know, you know, hearing the vendor or the manufacturer tell you how great their products are is usually pretty useless, right? You have to either see it for yourself or hear from a trusted source, right? So I ask you to go to YouTube and go to the RF Elements YouTube channel and look at all of our customer testimonials. We have a ton of interviews with customers, visits with customers, and listen to your brother and sister WISPs out there and how they've used our products, how they've helped, and how we've really delivered on everything that we said we'd do, right? So it's not just lip service from us. You can hear it from WISPs like yourself. So go to our YouTube channel. Also, our online community, right? So we have a forum. It's rfelab.com. This is, again, another great place to go to get information. Not only share your ideas, ask questions, or hear or find answers to questions you may have, right? So if you go to our forum, it's a great place to get great information. We also, if you like our swag, if you've seen some of our swag and you've missed it at trade shows and you want to get it, everybody who signs up for our forum gets a free t-shirt of their choice. So just go on out there for the free t-shirt, if anything. You don't have to even become part of the community if you don't want. We'd encourage you and really like it if you did. But by all means, just go to our forums, rfelab.com, and sign up and join the community. Finally, some trademark disclaimers here. So all third-party trademarks are used solely to reference the compatibility of RF Elements products. All rights of respective trade owners are reserved. So all the trademarks that we use, the names here, are only to reference the compatibility of our products. Thank you.